At Jiazhou, there lived a man by the name of Do Xu. One afternoon, he had just dozed off when he saw a man dressed in rough servant's clothing standing beside his bed, looking around nervously as if he wished to say something. He asked him what he wanted, and the man replied, "My master invites you to call on him." "And who, pray, is your master?" "He lives close by," was all the old man would say. So the two of them set off. After turning a corner, they came to a palace, where pavilion rose above storied pavilion in a succession of elaborately roofed buildings, and as they wound their way through this unending maze, it seemed to Do that he was entering a world utterly different from the world of men. Oh, hello again. Welcome to an edition of Strange Tales from my bookshelf. In Strange Tales, I discuss short story collections I have read, and they are invariably strange. Today I'm going to talk about Strange Tales from a Chinese Studio, also known as the Liaojai. These strange tales were written in 17th century China by Pu Songling, who was brilliant and thoroughly read, but never passed the final round of his imperial examinations. However, because of his brilliant book, he was declared a scholar of the first rank at the age of 71, 4 years before his death. Now, don't let the title fool you. These are not the same strange tales that you'll find in those weird tales or strange tales pulp magazines. Which isn't to say they're not plenty weird, because they certainly are. But they're of a different genre. Or, I suppose I should say, several different genres. Scholars have been studying and commenting on the Liaojai for centuries, and they have their own taxonomy that I don't remember offhand. But here are the genres I mentally sorted them into while I was reading. A given story might fall into one or more of them. The first category is fairy tales. Now, this category is kind of a catch-all for the stories that don't fall into the other categories I'm going to talk about. One of the common formulas in these fairy tales is that they start with the protagonist, who is often some sort of intellectual, scholar, or civil servant, which reflects Pu Songling's own background. Our hero encounters the supernatural or the extraordinary, and more often than not, because of his virtue, his wit, or his luck, he comes out the better for it. Maybe he ends up rich. Or maybe he ends up with a beautiful wife and many children. Some of my favorites from this genre are Princess Lotus, a passage of which I read to you at the start of this video, and another one is Past Lives. Now, for the most part, these are not the kind of fairy tales you want to read to your kids without previewing them first. I have the Penguin Classics edition, which was translated by John Minford, and some of these translations, most famously the one by Herbert Giles, yes, that Herbert Giles, are known for being rather bowdlerized or censored. This one is not. So there's quite a bit of sex in this book. Most of the time it's described rather unabashedly, frankly, and sometimes graphically. Which is interesting to see, since as a guy who's watched a lot of Chinese TV, it would seem to me that Chinese entertainment today is a bit more prudish. But that wasn't the case back in the 17th century, to hear it from this book. Back then, China was where the party was. Of course, this free-for-all seems to be limited to men. The women who take part in these escapades are usually sing-song girls, which I guess is this book's word for courtesan, or fox spirits, or ghosts, or women who otherwise don't have a reputation to protect. So there's a bit of a double standard there. But nonetheless, it makes for some entertaining reading. The next category I want to talk about is the ghost story. Now there are vengeful ghost stories, there are creepy tales of the undead, there are haunted house stories, but there are also plenty of ghost romances. And although we have ghost romances in the West, these tales take it even further. Ghosts can live happily ever after with their humans, and even bear children with them, rather than having to return to the ghost realm. Some examples of these tales are Spitting Water, which is a really creepy undead tale, and 20 Years a Dream, which is a very beautiful love story. The next category of story, which I think accounts for a plurality of the stories, is the fox story. According to Chinese mythology, when foxes acquire a certain amount of energy, they gain different powers, and one of them is to take different forms. Most often, this is the form of a beautiful young woman, although they can also take male form as well. Most fox stories begin with a simple formula. A respectable fellow is on the verge of sleep, when in his chambers there inexplicably appears a woman of unearthly beauty. She offers herself to him. Now, in my days as a single guy, I did not see anything like this. In fact, if it happened to me, I would suspect shenanigans. I would suspect that if I took her up on it, I would probably wake up in a bathtub full of ice with my kidneys missing. And of course, there are indeed shenanigans. She's a fox. Now, fox spirits can be benevolent as well as malevolent. So although sometimes the fox ends up gradually draining the man's life force through these sexual liaisons, other times, it's a happy union, and they live happily ever after. After overcoming some obstacles that being of, you know, two different species would probably produce. Examples of the fox story include catching a fox, fox trouble, fox control, the fox of Fenzhou, and fox in socks. Oh wait, I think that last one was Dr. Seuss. And the last genre that I've identified is the 17th century Chinese urban legend. I found these so remarkable because they were told in pretty much the same manner we tell urban legends today. They either begin or end by saying that the teller of this tale has heard it from a trusted friend of a friend, and that that person swore it was true. Sometimes these stories involve the supernatural, and sometimes these stories involve a curious or unlikely mundane occurrence. An example of this kind of tale would be The Monster and the Buckwheat, which tells the tale of villagers who fight off this monster, but you know, the monster disappears in the woods and no one ever hears about it again. Another is A Fatal Joke, in which a man accidentally hangs himself. So overall, I would highly recommend Strange Tales from a Chinese Studio. Now, the stories in the Liaojai are hit and miss, but out of 100 stories, it sure hits often enough. Even when they miss, they're very interesting in the ways that they defied the expectations of this modern Western reader. Although I should add that some stories defied my expectations to my delight, and I would not consider those misses. Sometimes you expect there to be more to one of these stories, but it abruptly ends. I think this happens more often in the urban legends, where the impact of the story really lies in it being recounted as the truth. Other times, in an otherwise very compact story, you have these seemingly irrelevant details, or an epilogue that doesn't really add much to the story, or doesn't need to be there. Again, I think the original tellers, or Pu Songling, might have thought these details added some veracity to the story, but I also suspect there's more going on here. Pu Songling wrote in the classical style and used a lot of wordplay. I suspect in the original Chinese, the significance of these passages would be much more apparent. This English version is very much in the vernacular, and the wordplay is probably impossible to translate. But there is extensive commentary at the back of this edition. I haven't read the commentary yet, but I definitely will for my favorite stories when I pick up this tome again, which I will certainly do. It has excellent replay value. It is a pleasure to reread and retell these stories. Again, I would highly recommend if you are into otherworldly curiosities, or have any interest in Chinese literature at all, or mythology or folk tales, that you pick up Strange Tales from a Chinese Studio. These tales will take you to another place, or rather, they will take you to two different places. One is the world in which the stories take place, a magical world of ghosts, fox spirits, demons, monsters, and wandering monks with magical powers. The other is the world in which these stories were read and shared, whether as fact or fantasy, the courtyards, studios, and gardens of dynastic China. As a bonus, my edition, Penguin Classics, contains many beautiful woodcuts to illustrate the stories. I don't know if the other editions have them or not. They should. The woodcuts are certainly old enough to be in the public domain. On a final note, while reading the Wikipedia entry on the Liaojai, I was delighted to discover that two of my favorite authors, Franz Kafka and Jorge Luis Borges, were inspired by the Liaojai. So, I don't think I can give a better recommendation than that. My name is Alex. I'll see you next time.